Welcome back. In the last unit, we visited the mineralogical museum and saw a vast number of different crystals having very different outer shapes, different morphologies. This is interesting and makes you wonder, how is it possible? We learned that there are only 7 crystal systems. However, there are almost countless different forms of appearance. Well, the first aspect that we have to consider is that most of the crystals do not occur as single crystals, which are composed of only one domain. Rather, we usually found crystals in nature as a bunch of crystals, as aggregates of several smaller crystals. But even if we take this into account and focus on single crystals, still there are a great number of different shapes. Let's have a look at the following example. Here you see a lovely shiny specimen of an aggregate of pyrite crystals. Some of them are intergrown, but you can clearly see the dominant cubic shapes. The cubic shape is the most prominent morphology of pyrite. And this is no surprise, because pyrite crystallizes indeed in the cubic crystal system. Pyrite, chemically viewed, is iron disulfide. It belongs to the cubic crystal system with the space group Pa3. Here, a picture of the unit cell is shown. The structure can be interpreted as a derivative of the rock salt structure. The iron ions are equivalent to the sodium ions, but instead of chlorine anions, we have such S2 2- dumbbells, resulting in an octahedral coordination sphere of the iron and the tetrahedral coordination sphere of the sulfur species. Now, the interesting thing is that not only cubes of pyrites can be found in nature, but also these shapes. An octahedron, a rhombic dodecahedron, a pentagon dodecahedron, and many more, which are combinations of these basic shapes. In total, more than 60 different shapes of pyrite crystals are known. For your interest, an interesting background article about the morphology of pyrite crystals can be found in the section References and Attachments. Perhaps you already recognized that some shapes seem to be endpoints, and some of them seem to be a sort of mixtures of two basic bodies. Now, the question is, how do we explain the occurrence of these different shapes, although the unit cell is cubic, and the only thing that it is allowed to build the whole crystal is to stack cubes together? The reason lies in the different relative phase developments during the crystal growth. If we take this cubical unit cell, and if the growth rate is equal for all spatial directions, then of course we get such a big cube at the end. But the speed of growth is not necessarily the same for all directions. If we take this scenario shown here at the bottom part of the slide, in which the rate of growth is obviously not the same for all different directions, then we will get an octahedron in the end. So, the sequence of different shapes of crystals, even if we only take one crystal system, here the cubic one, lies in the relative speed of growth in the different directions. And this means the crystals have different histories of development. And the deeper reason for this is the difference in growth mechanisms. And this in turn depends on the conditions in which the crystals grow. Namely, for instance, the concentration of the nucleation species, the temperature, the pressure, the conditions in general, and if there are gradients, and so on. In this context, I would like to mention an interesting webpage of the Museum of Minerals and Mathematics, located in a small village in the south of Germany. This webpage is worth a visit, even though it is in German, but that does not matter. Use the implemented Java tool, and with the help of these 3 sliders, you can generate very realistic crystal shapes. You can mix 3 basic shapes together to give different kinds of so-called intersection bodies. These resemble shapes that can be found for crystals of the cubic crystal system in nature. So, try it out, I find this very enlightening. One note, probably you will notice these funny three numbers in the form of triples. These are the so-called Miller indices. They are used to denominate the faces of crystals. And we will consider this system of nomenclature in the next unit. Now to some terminology. In order to describe the outer shapes of crystals, the morphology, there are two central terms: set of faces and habitus. And here in Germany we have a special term for set of faces, and this is Tracht, meaning costume or also dress. So the costume or the set of faces is the number and composition of different faces that build the outer limiting planes of the crystalline object. The habitus on the other side is related to the relative size of the different faces the crystal is composed of. Two crystals can have the same costume but a different habitus, and they can have the same habitus but different costumes. Let's look at this example shown here. All these three crystals possess the same set of faces, namely one hexagonal face on top, then six trapezoids, followed by six rectangles, six trapezoids again, and finally a hexagonal face as the basal face. This composition is identical for this shape, for that shape, and for that too. However, their relative sizes differ considerably. And this can be seen, for instance, if you compare the size of this trapezoid with that trapezoid, or this very long rectangle with this very wide one. And this results in an overall different habitus. This shape here on the left could be described as plate-like, this in the middle as column-like, and this on the right as almost isometric. Okay, the opposite is also true. Crystals of the same habitus can have very different set of faces. And this is shown here. All these crystal shapes have the same habitus. Here they are isometric, meaning they have roughly the same dimensions in the principal space directions, but they possess all different set of faces. The cube, for instance, is limited by 6 squares. The octahedron by 8 triangles. The rhombic dodecahedron by, as you can already tell by the name, by 12 rhombi, and so on. The terms set of faces and habitus are not only known in mineralogy, and this can be illustrated by these two photos. Here you can see our research colleagues Karl and Tamás. Obviously dressed nearly identical, this means same set of faces, but of course Karl is long and thin, rather the elongated type, and Tamás has mountains of muscles and is rather the sturdy type. And to give you another example, here you can see two photos of Michael. He has, of course, always the same habitus, but he is dressed differently. Here, sporty, and here in a more formal dress. Perhaps, I don't know, he is going out for dinner.